So thanks for inviting me, and thanks for coming. I have kind of a silly way to start. So there's this 1930s anthology of science fiction stories called If It Had Happened Otherwise. Has contributions from G.K. Chesterton and Winston Churchill. It imagines, like, each story imagines a famous historical turning point turning out the other way, like, what if Mary, Queen of Scots, had outsmarted Elizabeth, something like that. And so I want to make a contribution. What if Gromov had not invented J holomorphic curves? Well, right. So, preliminary answer is that we should be sad about it. I mean, there would be no theorems about holomorphic curves. But there's another line you sometimes hear, which is that you would have no theorems about symplectic geometry at all. And I think that that's wrong. Well, so in my counterfactual, so symplectic geometers, they went on studying symplectic geometry using kind of Arnold-style techniques instead of Gromov-style techniques. And they might have gotten someplace. So Arnold's theme, going back a long way, was topology of wavefronts. So this lecture, well, it's about microlocal sheaf theory. And one way to put it is that it's a very systematic way to study topology of wavefronts, especially algebraic topology of wavefronts. It's kind of discovered by accident by Japanese analysts. So I'll start with a rough outline, sheaves and operations, abstract, dry stuff that might be short. Okay, cosphere bundles and Legendrians and wavefronts. And okay, and then some sample applications. Well, it's sample applications of 1 to 2. Maybe I'll use this one. So sheaf theory is old. So maybe I'd like to get into it by describing it decade by decade. So in the 1940s, Larrey and Oka kind of invented sheaves as Étalé spaces. the 50s, Sayre, took up sheaves in algebraic geometry and came up with this point of view that they're pre-sheaves obeying a sheaf condition. Okay, 60s, Growth and Deke and Verdier. Started doing homological algebra with sheaves, studying complexes of sheaves, and operations, sheaf operations. And then, okay, since then, this technology has been getting better and better. And I guess I'll be working with it, kind of. Through the lecture, I'll be working with this high-tech stuff, but not very openly. I'm going to start with a definition of a sheaf, but in maybe this high-tech style. So here's first a not quite right definition. Kind of thinking about algebraic topology of wave fronts. A sheaf on X is going to be where wave fronts live later on. So I'd like to say that a sheaf on X is a cohomology theory. Cohomology theory defined only on the open subsets of X. So if you think about the Eilenberg-Steenrod axioms for cohomology theories, there are some of them that won't make sense here. But among the ones that do make sense, you should have a graded group that I'll write like this. Okay, if F is a sheaf, we should have a graded group for every open subset of X, and it should be a functorial in some contravariant way. So if V is a subset of U, we get a restriction map. And nothing else really makes sense except maybe a Meyer-Vietoris property, which I guess is not part of the original axioms for cohomology theory, but it's close enough. So we should have a connecting homomorphism, right, from HI of, which way does it go? Intersection. U intersect V to HI plus 1 to U union V. Okay. Making a long exact sequence with the usual thing. And there's no homotopy axiom or anything like that. And it's not quite right for really normal reason in algebraic topology, which is that we should have been working at chain level. So, here's a definition. Well, it is right. So a more or less in the Serre style. So a pre-sheaf on X, X is just some topological space, is a functor from the open subsets of X to, well, chain complexes, some category of chain complexes that I'll just write as D of Z, some kind of chain complexes of abelian groups. Well, interpreted in some high-tech way. So maybe it's a infinity category of stable infinity category of this ring Z. Opposite category, yes, contravariant functor. And a pre-sheaf is a sheaf. Well, if it obeys something like this Meyer-Via-Torres property souped up. So if whenever I have an open cover of an open subset of X, the restriction maps from F of U to F of V, where V is contained in one of the UIs, assemble to a isomorphism, quasi-isomorphism, from f of u to the limit of the f of u, oh, f of v, where this limit runs over open sets that are contained in one of these charts. So this should be a homotopy limit. And this probably should be some kind of homotopy functor. So whenever you have, or an infinity functor, I don't know if a functor in the world of infinity categories. So whenever you have a chain of open sets, you have a chain of restriction maps in this derived category, along with a lot of homotopies between compositions of those restriction maps. And there are ways to formalize that really neatly. So one example, right. Suppose X is a manifold to be safe, maybe locally contractible.
What if I only use the V's that are intersections of UIs?
That's usually okay.
Usually.
Well, that's always okay.
I mean, would it be the same definition? Or?
It would be, you would get the same sheaves.
Probably maybe you need it to be like locally finite.
So again?
Some local finite distribution.
Oh. Okay, local finiteness condition on X, or on the cover?
On
X. Okay, like it's paracompact or something? Okay.
Yeah, otherwise you can have like.
I'm sure that's not why you guys are here, though. So. Right. So then, if I look at the singular cochains, just singular cochains on open subsets of X, that's a sheaf. And so the usual Meyer-Via-Torres type properties for singular cohomology say that it's a sheaf. And it's the so-called constant sheaf, maybe written like this. Okay. And what makes sheaves useful, powerful, is the theory of sheaf operations. So for example, well, let me talk about stocks for a second. I don't know if that counts as a sheaf operation, but so if f is a sheaf, and x is a point, then there's a stock. Just f subscript little x. And it's the direct limit over open neighborhoods of x of the value of the sheaf on the open neighborhood. If you think of f as just being the collection of these stocks parameterized by points of x, that's not too far off. That's how Leray and Oka would have thought of them, plus some glue. Not too bad an approximation of what a sheaf is. Okay, and given continuous map between spaces, let me make a notation. Yeah, I'll just write sheaves on sh of x for it's a triangulated category or stable infinity category of sheaves on X, of sheaves of abelian groups or chain complexes of abelian groups on X. Okay, and given a continuous function between spaces, we get some functors between sheaf categories. Well, I'm only going to talk about two of them. Maybe there's a pullback functor from sheaves on Y to sheaves on X. There's a push forward functor in the other direction. These two other ones, written F lower shriek and F upper shriek. So F lower star is just given by a formula. So if I have an open subset of Y, and I want to evaluate F lower star of capital F on that open subset, I can take the inverse image. That's an open subset of X, and I can evaluate F, capital F, on that open subset, on that inverse image. All right. So it's harder to write a formula for F upper star. So intuitively, it's given by these stocks. So let's see, a stock of F upper star of capital F at X is is the stock of capital F at F of X. Okay, again, X of X. Maybe more formally, F upper star is determined by its property of being the left adjoint to F lower star. One can write it as the sheafification of a colimit, possibly. I will. There'll be more of that on Friday.
Yes,
they are natural transformations of functors. But what are they geometrically is, it's possible to say something. Well, there are these two others. And then there are two more after that called tensor and maybe Hom with an underline. These are the six operations of sheaf theory and of a lot of other things. I think what makes
when you find that it's poor about using spots or characterization. I mean, if I think of sheaves of functions, say holomorphic functions, then the stokes are germs. But I thought that pullback was in terms of the fiber, not in terms of the stoke.
When you're talking about holomorphic, there's a sheaf of. So this is a sheaf of modules over the sheaf of locally constant functions instead of the sheaf of holomorphic functions.
More questions?
So I don't want to give too many examples. That's right. But I'll give some examples on Friday. Okay. So let's talk about locally constant sheaves. So if X is locally contractible, let's just say manifold, the following are equivalent. F is locally constant. Is the constant sheaf still on the board? Yeah. Maybe not with these coefficients, but with isomorphic to a here, locally isomorphic to a constant sheaf of the form MX, where M belongs to D of Z. And whenever U and V are contractible open sets, and V is contained in U, the restriction map from F of U to F of V is an isomorphism. So, for example, you can cook up locally constant sheaves from representations of the fundamental group. Or you can do things that take advantage of the rest of the algebraic topology of X, like this. So if, if I take the Hopf map, that's a map from S3 to S2, and I push forward the constant sheaf on S3, this is locally constant on S2. So this is a sheaf on the two-sphere whose stalks at a point in the two-sphere is, it's co-chains on some circle. So it lives in 2 degrees, but as in some sense, even though the two-sphere is not simply connected, as you move around that two-sphere, those stalks vary, but in a locally constant fashion. So let's write, lock X inside of sheaves on X for the full subcategory of locally constant sheaves. Position is that this category is equivalent to the category of DG modules. If X is connected, DG modules over the chain algebra on the based loop space of X. The way you prove it, basically tell you what the forget the module structure map is, and it's the stalk at some base point. Step one is that triangle commutes. It's not the proof.
You didn't say what the other dotted map is.
So you start there. This functor is representable by more or less. If I take the path loop vibration and I take the constant sheaf on this contractible path space and I push it forward to X, I don't actually get this an object representing this stalk functor. I get an object representing the dual of this stalk functor.
What is the statement?
There exists a natural isomorphism of categories.
If X
is connected, yeah.
Connect.
Well, and X is a manifold.
Can
There's a locally constant sheaf on X that represents the stock functor, at least when restricted to locally constant sheaves. And its endomorphism ring is the co-chain algebra of the based loop space.
I think maybe one point is that you just went from saying representable by this map, by this vibration, and it's not obvious how this vibration gives rise to the sheaf. Of course, you just did it over the
okay.
There you go.
So this is not quite right. It's not quite representable by this. Okay. But that's something like that sheaf is something like the dual vector space of the representing object. Okay. So microlocal.
The arrow that goes diagonally left down is tensoring with the one-dimensional module.
Is forgetting the module structure. Yep, of a module over a ring. So it's an abelian group with an action of the ring. So forget the ring and the action of the ring. And you're just left with an abelian group. You get some one-dimensional module over this.
I get it.
Yes.
But it doesn't seem a stalk at it. Okay,
fine.
Well, by computing the endomorphism ring of this stalk functor, or equivalently the endomorphism ring of the representing object. Yes.
Then you're saying its stalk will be obtained by taking this push forward. It should be, so that's just that's just changed on the loop space as a module over itself.
Yes.
The loop space is a group, so it has an augmentation.
But the forget the module structure is represented by the free module.
Sorry,
yes.
What's the chain complex? If I start with just Z sub X,
then you get a one-dimensional.
It's a one-dimensional chain.
Which is, every loop acts as one.
Ah,
trivial representation.
Okay.
Trivial representation.
Good.
And then you forget it, you just get Z.
Okay.
Does anybody want to see this written down?
Yes.
Yeah.
If I take Z sub X, it will go to.
So this is this orange isomorphism. Z sub x goes to z concentrated in degree 0 with the based loop chains on the based loop space of x acting on z, where every loop acts trivially. Well, maybe it's better to say that omega x acts on z trivially.
Sorry, I didn't get what your orange arrow did. I mean, what I see is that you have a locally constant sheaf. You have some monodromy, and that completely describes it, right?
No, not in the dimensions.
Okay, so what am I missing?
There's
there are the other pages of the Serre spectral sequence.
Maybe it would be helpful.
Where is the Serre spectral sequence?
Why don't we write that whole thing as a an extension of the trivial, of the constant sheaf on S2 by itself.
So maybe here's how you can think of this. So let's take the path space on X, that's a contractible space, and theorem one is that locally constant sheaves on a contractible space are vector spaces. Okay. So locally constant sheaves on a contractible space are vector spaces, and then you have a functor this gives you this object that David is talking about, and then you take endomorphism of this object and you get the weak case.
Do you guys want to see the Hopf map example? I think, or maybe the problem is that I'm not being precise enough, which I thought was going to save me time, and maybe didn't. But but I'm going to continue not being too precise. There is let's give a monodromy description. Of this Hopf lower star of the constant sheaf. here's a two-sphere. So if I have a base point on the two-sphere, or just a point on the two-sphere, better to not choose a base point exactly. Let's take the north and the south pole of the two-sphere. So the stock up here is the cohomology of some circle, which is z in degree 0, z in degree 1, and 0 in other degrees, with a 0 differential between them, and quasi-isomorphic to that anyway. And down here, it's the same. And if I have a path, if I have a green path, from the north pole to the south pole, that's going to induce the identity map. Oh, it's in green, so this should also be in green. But that green path, it has an interesting homotopy from it to itself. So there's an interesting path in the space of paths on this two-sphere, which will, if you think it through, will turn into some kind of cycle rather on this loop space. And what that does, so that homotopy kind of takes that path and it rotates it around the circle around the two sphere. And that homotopy is not trivial. That homotopy is the induced homotopy here is some kind of chain homotopy between this chain map and itself. And it's this part of that chain homotopy is not zero. Okay. Let's talk about micro-local stuff. It's just easier to draw the homotopy. That was the only reason. okay, micro-local stuff. So if M is a manifold, I'm going to write T with a superscript infinity of M for kind of the boundary of the cotangent bundle of M, boundary at infinity. So it's a sphere bundle of large radius inside of that cotangent bundle. So it's a contact manifold, or anyway, it has a contact structure. It's called the cosphere bundle. And if I have a, I guess technically any closed subset of this cosphere bundle, ultimately, it's interesting for Legendrian or coisotropic things, but and not for other things. So if I have a closed subset of this cosphere bundle, then I want to give, we'll build a category called, I'll just call it C of lambda, which is not, this category is 30 years old or so, but that notation is not. Okay. So in such a way that if lambda prime is contact isotopic, if there's some isotopy of lambda to lambda prime, then these categories are equivalent. Eventually, but
is it locally contractible?
Lambda?
Yeah.
Probably not necessarily. Why not? I mean, but yeah, it's Legendrian. Maybe it's allowed to be singular. Maybe the real generality that I might want to buy is that you should think of it as it could be a singular Legendrian. Well, no, that's not right. Well, I mean, because I won't be able to define it for you in this lecture for any closed set. Kashiwara and Shapira do, but I only really know how to get at, well, I only really know how to explain how to get at this category from stratified Morse theory, which requires some Legendrian hypothesis. So the definition of this category is Kashiwara-Shapira. This theorem, I guess, is more recent, Guillermo Kashiwara-Shapira. I'll write their names on the board later, more than their initials. Yeah?
When you said this category is defined by Kashiwara-Shapira, just like 20 years ago? Or
I mean, they worked on it through the 80s, I guess.
Last theorem, when you say Kashiwara-Shapira, that means like years.
Yes.
So I'm a little bit confused. If this category existed.
Yes, there was some kind of blind spot. People didn't really.
Well, the question is, are you interested in contact isotopes that are not induced by diffeomorphisms of the manifold, and why?
Okay.
So, the guy who had an idea that made these guys write a paper was Dima Tamarkin. Which was, maybe you could use this stuff to prove theorems about symplectic topology. That was the idea, and it was right. Well, okay. So here's an example. If lambda is empty, then the C of lambda is going to be the category of locally constant sheaves on M. Okay, so if lambda is not empty, well, in general, C of lambda is defined as a full subcategory, category of sheaves on M. So if lambda is Legendrian, we can get at it with stratification theory and stratified Morse theory. So here's step one. There is a Whitney stratification. S. So that's some kind of union of some way of writing. Did I call it M? M as a disjoint union of locally closed submanifolds, such that lambda is contained in lambda sub S, where this is the conormal variety to S. So this assertion, I mean, sometimes it's a theorem of Whitney or René Thom, or and sometimes it's a hypothesis. It's some kind of tameness hypothesis on lambda. So I guess that's especially necessary if lambda is not compact. So this lambda sub S, it's the union over all these submanifolds that M is the disjoint union of these conormals. Read it like this. So this is if this is the boundary of the cotangent bundle, then this is the boundary of the conormal bundle in that cotangent bundle. So the C of lambda S is going to be the category of S constructible sheaves. On
M.
It's on the zero section. Well, which is not a sec. It's on the base of the cosphere bundle. Well, so what are those? They're sheaves whose restriction to each stratum is locally constant. Yes. So maybe give you a couple of relevant examples of this lambda S. So if lambda is say a co-circle fiber of T infinity of R2, say at 0, 0, right? Then this for lambda S. So the projection of lambda to R2 is just a point. And S can be the stratification by that point and the complement. But if I wiggle this lambda a little bit, S is the stratification by a point and its complement.
So lambda is empty everywhere.
Yes. Lambda is already equal to lambda S. But if I take that co-circle bundle and I move it a little bit by an isotopy, then the projection will no longer be a point. But it'll look maybe like this. Okay. So it'll be some kind of hypersurface in R2. This circle bundle, it's the oriented version or co-oriented version. So not just any hypersurface, but a co-oriented hypersurface where almost everywhere there's some normal direction. One of the two normal directions is distinguished. Okay, so then what does this lambda sub S look like then? Well, S is maybe going to be the obvious stratification, the visually obvious stratification, where I have some some points where this thing has crossings or singularities, and then the interval is along lambda itself, and then the complement, these chambers. Lambda itself, this picture is called a wave front or front projection of a Legendrian. It's some kind of singular hypersurface. Not every kind of singularity can appear. But the Legendrian itself, it's just some circle. Let me make this easier on myself. Make only one little fishtail. OK, so there's some circle in the cosphere bundle of R2, which is the Legendrian lift of this. There's kind of a 180-degree opposite version of that, right, where if I had taken these co-normal directions instead. And then at every point, I have this whole circle, this whole cotangent circle, maybe co-circle. So there are three of those. And what do they look like? I don't know, something like one of them kind of looks like that, and one of them I don't know. This might not quite be right, but the point is, it's the white Legendrian that we want to study, and we've embedded it in this lambda sub S, where S looks like this, and now it has all this extra junk on it, which are in color. So step two. Yeah.
Stratification. It's not unique.
Not unique at all. No.
Yeah.
That's right. So this is really this lambda sub S is not any kind of invariant of lambda. But it is possible to find one.
How did you go from the picture on the left to the picture on the right?
What lift is this? Not very systematically. I know that the Legendrian is a circle, so I drew a white circle. I know that there's some kind of. I'm interested in this kind of outward conormal lift, but the stratification, the conormal to the stratification includes both directions. So I drew a second copy of that white circle, now in green. And then there were these.
Shouldn't there be three circles?
Yeah, why is it three circles?
There should be three purple circles. I got tired.
So the white and green are. One of them is
white
lambda
is just lambda.
Minus lambda?
Minus lambda, okay.
Yeah. And these are just some unnecessary
fibers.
Yeah, fibers. At different points, why?
Particularly, they intersect, and they're probably like tangent.
They intersect the white and the green, but I think they're not tangent to the white and the green in the co-circle bundle. Although if you moved them a little bit by a Legendrian isotopy and then projected them, then you would see some tangency. Okay. Okay, so to get at C of lambda, so step two, or was this already? Yeah, this was step one. Step two is that we somehow cut out C of lambda inside of C of lambda sub S using stratified Morse theory. Who's creators are in the audience. So for every for every point x, comma, c, so that's supposed to be a cotangent vector. Maybe this is really a cotangent ray inside of lambda sub s, but not the singular part of lambda sub s. So for any x, comma, c in the smooth part of lambda sub s. So maybe here's one. Define a Morse group, which is a functor from S constructible sheaves to vector spaces or abelian groups. Okay. As follows. So an object. Oh, okay. So for first, pick a function g. From M to R, whose derivative at x is equal to c. Oh, wait, c is a ray, so maybe it belongs to the ray c. And then, do Morse theory. So if I have a sheaf F, what does Morse theory mean? It means you look at the sublevel set where you stop just after a critical point, and you subtract the sublevel set where you stop just before a critical point. So what that means in this case is I'm going to take a little epsilon ball around x. I'm going to intersect it with a sublevel set where my critical value is g. It's called g of x. So pretend that x is a critical point of this function g, although it might not literally be, and then add a little delta. Okay. So that's an open set. So I can evaluate F on that open set. And there's a slightly smaller open set. I can take the restriction inside that same epsilon ball. I look at a sublevel set where I stop just before the critical value. Okay, so there's a restriction map from here to here, and I can take the cone on that restriction map. that is going to be the Morse group at x, comma, c of f. So it's a difficult theorem. Mark Gorisky and Bob McPherson. But this is well defined. I just got nervous that psi is a point in a cosphere bundle instead of a. Let me just say it belongs is equal to psi, or some rescaling of it. Okay. So now, what is C of lambda? The full subcategory of sheaves for which this mu x c of f, or Morse x c of f, is acyclic when ever x comma c belongs to lambda s but not to lambda. Okay, so this is not actually Kashiwara and Shapira's definition of C of lambda. And for a long time, I couldn't really believe that it worked. Because they defined this category without doing any stratified Morse theory. I guess. Now, it does work, but maybe you have to be more careful about boundedness assumptions on your chain complexes, at least for now. But I'm not sure where I'm going with that. So it's a theorem, anyway, that, first of all, that's independent of S. Basically, Kashiwara and Shapira. Yeah, well, I said I'd write their names. Different way of getting at the singular support, of getting at the complement of the singular support, which uses Morse theory but no stratification. Well, yeah, some flavor of Morse theory but no stratification theory. So in particular, you can define the singular support of a non-constructible sheaf. I believe it. I didn't understand how it could work, but it seems to work. So anyway, this category, it's independent of S, of course. It's the category of sheaves with singular support in lambda. And a recent theorem, the Q Guillermo, Kashiwara, and Shapira. So if lambda and lambda prime are Legendrian isotopic, then C of lambda is equivalent to C of lambda prime. What kind of time do I have? Is it 2 minutes?
Okay. 2 minutes, yes.
Okay, well, there are some applications. But I'll stop.